Hello, welcome along to the Yorkshire Football Show. It's that time we can get to have a look at everything happening in the world of Yorkshire football. FA Cup and Football League on the agenda this week. Pleased to say we're joined by Sam Brydges, formerly Mr. York. Sam, how are you doing?
I'm all right, Danny.
Ah, good stuff. And Joe, thanks for filling in for me last week.
No worries, pleasure.
I get the one holiday a year. I think that's enough for anyone now, isn't it?
No.
Apart from Joe, yeah. He needs to top up his tank.
He did a real good job. Good job, did Joe.
That's fair enough. That's fair enough.
Watch out.
That's fair enough.
That's from the boss. And I say 5 weeks holiday at the very least a year. I like my holidays.
Topping up the tan at the salons as well.
Well,
you know.
I don't. I'm not David Dickinson, you know.
Well, you get it that way.
I just look that, you know, sat next to you, and when Derek's about as well, a pale ginger Scotsman, I just look tanned.
No, fair enough.
Well, tell you what, David Dickinson's got less grey in his hair.
Anyway,
that's the best way. Let's go on to some of the football
action
before we all get into fisticuffs here. Let's have a look over at Huddersfield Town. That's where we're going to start, because it was a massive FA Cup game over at the John Smith Stadium. Massive crowd as well, over 24,000 packed in there. There wasn't a spare seat in the house. And managing to keep Pep Guardiola's men back to a 0-0 draw. They really deserve that one.
Yeah, I mean, Huddersfield made 7 changes to the side as well. So you look at the amount of changes Man City made. I think they made 8 in total. But they were world-class players coming back into the side, the likes of Aguero and Nolito. So, you know, the squad is that strong. Whoever Man City decides to put out, it's going to be a good Premier League side. Huddersfield, they sort of used the rotation system all campaign, haven't they? I mean, David Wagner often says, particularly about some of the German based players before this season, that they're not used to the amount of football in such a short space of time. They're used to having a winter break, so they can't cope with playing 2 games a week, which I always think for a professional footballer, you know, of course you can man up a bit, but you know, he's used the rotation system well. It's been successful and it works again. Dean Whitehead came into the side and played really well. The young goalkeeper Coleman made some good saves, and Huddersfield deserved the replay. Actually, Claudio Bravo called into action on a couple of occasions as well, and you know, it could have easily been an upset and a home win, but on the balance of play you take that, because Coleman made a couple of good saves from one-on-ones, and now a replay, not really what either manager would have wanted before the game, but an opportunity for Huddersfield to go to the Etihad and really get a taste of what they could have next season, because they're so close to obviously achieving Premier League football.
Yeah, I'm loving the Spanish pronunciation of the Etihad as well. I'm loving it. What do you make of it, Sam? Because obviously they've got themselves a replay over at the Etihad now as well. Is it just one game at a time, getting that consistency, or are the games just going to pile up now for Huddersfield Town?
Well, possibly a little bit, but I'm sure they'll relish going to the Etihad in a couple of weeks' time. As Joe says, perfect opportunity for David Wagner to say to his players, look, this is what you could have week in, week out next season. It's a real opportunity for them to go and experience that. You saw a lot of the players at the weekend on social media tweeting they can't believe they're playing against a Pep Guardiola team, but again, this is the opportunity to go to a big stadium that you're home of, Manchester City, and for David Wagner to keep relaying this message to them, this is how close you are now to playing Premier League football week in, week out. As Joe said, they rotated as well as City did at the weekend, so yeah, it's not a massive issue for them, I don't think. David Wagner at the start of the season was smart, getting in 2 players for every position. He made that clear at the start of the season, that's what he was doing, he was building that squad. So yeah, they're in a decent position, and you know, City are also in the Champions League obviously as well. So you may see an even weaker Manchester City team at the Etihad. Pep might feel in front of the home crowd, he can maybe blood a couple of youngsters. So it could be an even weaker team and a real opportunity for Huddersfield to go and beat City and really then, you know, get some real big confidence ahead of this running.
Because Man City now have the Champions League game this week, then the FA Cup replay, then the second Champions League game, and it's the fixture build up for them, who were, you know, they're not guaranteed a top 4 spot, are they, in the Premier League? It's really tight, and it's a real problem for both managers really, but at least Huddersfield have more of a cushion between themselves and 7th place in the Championship, whereas the Premier League is really tight, and Manchester City just can't afford to slip up in the Premier League at the minute. And Champions League, you think that's Pep Guardiola's competition, that's what he's been brought into Manchester City for, to win. So, you know, real opportunity for an upset for Huddersfield Town, and you know, then you're only a game away from a Wembley semi-final, aren't you? So
yeah, there's so much confidence in the team though. The Championship, sometimes you play so many games that when you are in that kind of form and you win week in, week out, you kind of bounce between the games. I don't think one more game is going to affect them. They're going to play a lot of games this season, over 50, 60 games probably by the end of it. So it's not going to matter. And obviously, everyone wants to go and play against the best. That's what they're going to be doing. So it's only going to buoy them.
Yeah, no, that's very true indeed. It shows the squad depth that they've had. This sort of said for quite some time, I think they definitely will be in the playoffs or even in the top two, just because of purely how much they can do. You look at Dean Whitehead and Stankovic being able to come in, the likes of Michael Heffel and Christoph Schindler, you know, that's a massive one for me, is that. Anyway, let's hear from David Wagner. He was speaking to our man Derek Clark after that game against Manchester City.
Man City was hundreds of millions of pounds worth of talent assembled, but he didn't look out of place today.
To be fair, I've seen in some moments this quality and how strong they are. But I think you have to make one thing right, and this is you have to have the right attitude, and you have to be brave enough. And this was what we've shown today. And I think that it was a great team performance, and because of this, I think they deserve this rematch in a great environment.
And you'll be hoping to play against teams of that quality next season, every week. Hope to play that.
I'm happy to play on Tuesday against Reading, hopefully with the same performance and the same support from the stands. And there we have to make sure that we are as fresh as we can and show again our identity, and hopefully we are able to get another positive result.
Joe Coleman hasn't played much for you this season, but he showed again what a terrific goalkeeper he is.
Yeah, to be fair, it was his first draw now, so I'm not happy with him. No, he's great. So he played one game in the Championship that we've won, and he took now three clean sheets in the FA Cup. It was another very, very good performance from him. He is a goalkeeper talent, what we have. And I think he was very, very focused, very concentrated, very brave as well, like the whole team. And I think it was a very good team performance with a very good goalkeeper performance as well.
That was David Wagner speak to our man Derek Clark after that game at the John Smith Stadium. And a first-time appearance for Pep Guardiola at the Yorkshire Football Show. He was speaking to our man Derek Clark after that game against Huddersfield Town.
I said a big compliment to the team, because I know how difficult it is. That game's the pitch, today's a goal play in rugby, and everything is a little bit slow in the process to the pass. They are so aggressive, they are so dynamic. They have a really good team, that's why they are where they are in the Championship. So, okay.
Pep Guardiola there speaking to our man Derek Clark, and he's always welcome here on the Yorkshire Football Show. I'm sure one of the lads would give up their seat at some point, Joe.
Yeah, he can have my seat, though he's probably got inferior knowledge of Yorkshire football. So
of course I'd like to probably see him do it a cold Tuesday night over at York there. So.
Exactly, yeah. And to be fair, Joe's a bit more stylish.
Oh, that's I'll give you that. He's not Marco Silva, but we'll give him that.
I might have grey hair, but at least I've got a hair, Pep. Yeah.
We'll find the positives. Anyway, let's have a look over at Leeds United. It was a draw for them down at Portman Road this weekend, and it seemed a hard fought draw, but another bit of a bad day at the office for Leeds.
Yeah, it was a poor performance actually from the Whites. I think Ipswich were the better side, but you know, they've gone away from home, not played well, and brought a point back, which they wouldn't have done last season. So that's the positive. Bit of a worry though, how the form has dipped a little bit in recent weeks. I don't think the January signings have had the impact that Gary Monk would have possibly hoped. And this weekend, it is massive. The Yorkshire Derby against Sheffield Wednesday. The one good thing for Leeds is that Norwich have dropped points on them, so they've extended the gap. Fulham obviously have a game in hand because they were in FA Cup action, and Derby have a couple of games in hand, which, you know, they're going to really push on. If they win both of them, I think the gap goes down to 2 points between Derby and Leeds, and I think Fulham also in a similar sort of situation. But you'd rather have the points on the board, wouldn't you? Which, you know, Leeds and Gary Monk have. And it's just a little bit of a blip, but back at Elland Road in front of the home fans, big Yorkshire Derby, they'll fancy themselves to get back to winning ways, but they have some tough fixtures coming up, and this is the business end of the season now, and it's where Leeds, they need to start bringing out the best form again, because it has dipped in recent weeks.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Do you think it is just a bit of a dip in form? So do you think it's a problem playing against the likes of Neil Warnock's Cardiff and Mick McCarthy's Ipswich, you know, that kind of style of football?
Yeah, possibly. I think, you know, when you come quite far in a short space of time, which Leeds have done under Gary Monk, teams then start to find you out, the hunter becomes a hunted and all that. So that's happened a little bit over the last few weeks for Leeds, but I just think the performance levels have dipped. Just looking at some of the goals they're conceding, particularly through midfield, they're just, I don't know, it's lacking a bit of bite that they had maybe a few weeks ago. So yeah, it's I'm sure Gary Monk's, you know, trying to put his finger on it and get it sorted out, but yeah, there's just a little bit there at the moment. They're just not quite at it, whereas you look at Huddersfield, who, when they've had their bad run of forms, they've always seemed to bounce back and be out, which Leeds were doing early in the season. But I don't know, there just seems to be something just not quite there. They're not the same intensity there was a few weeks ago for Leeds, but yeah, there's still plenty of time. As Joe said, Derby, if they can get their act together, can put some real pressure on the teams in fifth and sixth. But it seems all season that none of those teams outside the top six have really got it together, and no one's really knocking on the door too hard. Whenever it seems like they're coming, they have a couple of defeats and fall away a little bit. So it is a real opportunity for all of the top six to secure their place in the next a few weeks, because no one's really getting their act together. So yeah, Leeds need to, and it's an intriguing game on Saturday, the Sheffield Wednesday one. They've had some good form, we'll talk about them shortly, but yeah, it's going to be a tough test, because they're going to come, we spoke many times over the last couple of weeks about their attacking power now for Wednesday.
Yeah, no doubt about that. We'll move on to Sheffield Wednesday in just a second. But first off, for Leeds United, got to look over at Elland Road. It's important that they keep that fortress, because that's really what's been getting some good form this season.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a different place entirely, hasn't it, this season under Gary Monk. Despite a slow start, they went on an impressive run. I think it was 8 games unbeaten at home. So, yeah, a massive crowd coming up on Saturday for this huge game. The intriguing thing for me will be who he selects in midfield, because we know that Liam Bridcut, the skipper, is back fit, came back into the side on Saturday. O'Kane has been in and out of the team. Vieira has been the standout, but a young player being asked to do that defensive holding job week in, week out. You know, this is his first season of week in, week out football. Maybe it's taken a little bit of toll on him. And Phillips has done really well this season as well. So I think the midfield is key for the game coming up on Saturday, and it will be interesting to see who gets the nod. Charlie Taylor, we hear, should be back fit as well, which is going to be a huge boost for Leeds, and maybe at the right time, because I think they've started to ship a few goals, because the defence has been changing a little bit. We know suspensions and injuries with Janssen being out, Bartley being out at times, and obviously Taylor has had a bit of a long layoff. So that's why I think they've started to concede. If they can get the stable back four with Aylin, Janssen, Bartley and Taylor and keep them fit for the rest of the season, then I'm sure top six, no problem.
Yeah, well, we're talking about that in just a second as well, and having a look ahead to that game against Sheffield Wednesday. But first, let's hear from Gary Monk, who was speaking to our man Mark Wilson after that game down at Portman Road.
Yeah, we knew it was going to be a difficult game, especially Ipswich, been in good form recently, having some good results against some good teams. So
we knew it was going to be extra difficult here. I think obviously the conditions as well, the pitch didn't help both teams, or especially in terms of trying to play our football. But we tried to pass the ball. I thought we started very well the first 10 minutes. I think the goal came against the run of play. It was the first time that we really made a mistake and they scored from it. But then I think we didn't react well to the first goal. I thought we started to make too many mistakes, which invited pressure from Ipswich, and quite like their first goal, we probably scored our goal against the run of play at the end of the half. So, but that enabled us to have a little talk at half time. We tried to gain more control in the second half. We tried to play, which was difficult. And credit to Ipswich as well. I thought they defended very well. I thought we defended very well. I think the game at 1-1 could have, it looked like it would be decided maybe by a set piece or a mistake, but we stayed concentrated to the end, and overall I think it was a deserved point and a good point.
Yeah, good point, and the point at the end of the season could be crucial.
Yeah, but we're not focused on anything else. We're focused on ourselves. We tried to give our maximum today. You could see the commitment was there, fought against a good side that was, you know, playing well in good form, and I thought they were very physical as well. So it was a very physical game. I thought there was a lot of tight bodies on that pitch, but we dug in, and yeah, overall I think it was a deserved point.
Last one for me, Charlie Taylor, any chance for next week?
Yeah, he should be back in training on Tuesday, so he's penciled in for Tuesday. Great to have Charlie back. He'll come into the squad, but we have to have a good look at him and assess him. We know where he is physically, but once he's back out onto the pitches football-wise with ourselves, we'll have a good look at him and see when he's available for a selection.
That was Gary Monk speaking to our man Matt Wilson. He also caught up with Mick McCarthy down at the game after that 1-1 draw.
Mick, you had some nice words to say about Leeds before the game. What did you make of their performance, and you know, how would you assess their chances of getting in the playoffs after that one?
I think they've come up against really the team who's been playing well and found it very hard to play. And they brought a lot of passes in the second half. I think they're an excellent team. They've come off, their players are saying, "You know, we don't want to play against you lot every week." But that's not being us every week either. But then again, we've got different players on the pitch and players who are fit. So I think Leeds are a good side. I think Gary Monk's been amazing from the start that he had. And to get them playing the way they play and have the results and get that club, because as everybody knows, I'm a Leeds fan, because the Leeds fan, when they're beaten, has usually seen Mick McCarthy's a Leeds fan. They must have forgot today. or maybe we were playing well enough for them to forget. That was 100 years ago. I was just seeing one of my heroes, actually, Eddie Gray outside. So they're a good side. He's got good players in there, and I think they've just had a bit of a tough time, haven't they, from then going really well. But yeah, it happens. I remember getting promoted with Wolves and we didn't win a game for 13 games. It's just not easy. The league's not easy, but I think they'll be in the playoffs, there's no doubt about that.
That was Yorkshire's very own Mick McCarthy there speaking to our man Matt Wilson. A very Yorkshire press conference all around, that's what we like to see. Let's have a look ahead to Leeds United against Sheffield Wednesday then. And Joe, if they want to put it right, it's the game to do it, because it's going to be a massive crowd, a massive atmosphere. I can't wait for that.
Yeah, it's going to be huge. And Wednesday go into this game with their tails high, don't they? I mean,
tails high?
Tails flying high.
That's a fantastic saying. We'll have to use that more often here on the Yorkshire Football Show.
Their tails are up, aren't they? Well, you know, they've got momentum. Momentum from their run of wins, even though they've had to grind out victories in the last few weeks. The performances haven't been great, but then they put that right on Saturday at the City Ground. They were a lot better than they have been in recent weeks, despite being under the cosh, conceding that goal after going two up. Forestieri seemingly back to form. He was in the crowd, wasn't he, celebrating after scoring. And Armin Abdi with a cracker, goal of the day, you know, finding the top corner. And he could be a big player for Sheffield Wednesday as we approach the business end of the campaign, because Wednesday fans have not seen the best of him. He's struggled with injuries and form since coming from Watford. And this is a player who, you know, at the start of the season, he's done really well for Watford in their previous couple of campaigns. Wednesday fans are like, this will be the difference to us getting promoted. Barry Bannon has had a slip in form, and Abdi coming back into the side could be good timing. And again, I spoke about the midfield for Leeds. I think it's key to who Sheffield Wednesday select, and that's going to be the big thing about this game on Saturday. And can't wait to listen to it on Radio Yorkshire 12:30, because it really is a 50-50 game. Despite it being at Elland Road, I think team selection will be the big thing. And who can be the best defensively? Because both sides have goals in the team, but both have been shipping goals as well in recent weeks.
Yeah, you're right there. Shame it is an early kick-off, mind. I always like to see these at 3 o'clock. But lads, since it's so close, I'm just going to get a quick prediction off you for this one. Who do you think will take it, Sam, Leeds or Sheffield Wednesday?
Oh, do you know what? With the form that Leeds are in at the moment, I can see Sheffield Wednesday going there, smash and grab performance, just with the firepower that we've got. Joe mentioned Forestieri there, looks back to himself, hungry, on the ball. Yeah, so I'm going to say Sheffield Wednesday go and take it.
How about yourself, Joe?
I think, an early prediction would be Sheffield Wednesday, but team selection is going to be key. it'll be interesting to see who both managers select to play midfield, and I think this game is going to be won centre of the park, so that's key. Obviously Wednesday have a game Tuesday as well. They go to Brentford. They can be above Leeds in the table if they get the points on Tuesday night, so that can make it an even bigger game for Leeds. And you know, that is something that Gary Monk can use as motivation. Look, we can be back above these. It's could be a must-win game for the White. So it's really interesting. But at this stage, I would have to say Sheffield Wednesday, like Sam.
Well, I'm just going to go for Leeds to edge it as well. I'm going to go the other side of that one. I just see them edging this one and it being an upturn in form for Leeds.
It's a pick
now.
And game. It's 50
it really
bit.
Is. I could see it going either way. Yeah, I wouldn't surprise if I
think
were
it's
wrong.
Going to be great to listen to and watch.
Yeah, no doubt about that. 30,000 in there should be an absolutely fantastic crowd. Really looking forward to it. Let's have a look elsewhere. Sam, let's have a look over at Barnsley. They lost 2-0 to Brighton this weekend. Dark horses for promotion around Christmas. Do you think that's a step too far for them now?
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, ninth, where they are at the moment, would be an excellent season, as we kind of said, over the course of the last few weeks. They probably don't have enough. They've had to rebuild in January, losing some of their better players. But they're still in it. They're still playing well. They're still playing for the manager. And it's, yeah, I think definitely top half of the table finish should be Barnes' aim. Maybe they'll have a knock on the door, as we've said. Not too many consistent teams outside of the top six, so they do have an opportunity to have a go. But I think, you know, when they come up against teams with real quality, they will start to struggle. Now I think for next season, you know, they'll come back and again probably be similar to a Preston, the job that Simon Grayson's done there, that they'll kind of hover around mid table for a while now. But yeah, the manager's done a fantastic job, and yeah, certainly no shame at the weekend losing to a quality Brighton team.
Yeah, that's the way to look at it as well, I suppose, isn't it, Joe? Because Brighton are a very slick outfit. There's no shame in losing.
Well, no, but at 0-0, Barnsley could have had a penalty. In fact, I think a stonewall penalty for a handball inside the area. And, you know, that could have been a different game. Paul Heckingbottom very disappointed with the manner of Brighton's goals as well, because Barnsley gave possession away in bad areas. And, you know, when you've got a Brighton side who are challenging, and you know, Sam Baldock with a clinical finish, and you know, they have some quality plays. You can't give the ball away in dangerous areas, because a team like Brighton will punish you, and that's what they did on Saturday.
Yeah, no doubt about that. We'll keep today with all the latest Barnsley, Leeds, Huddersfield and Sheffield Wednesday news right here on Radio Yorkshire, so make sure you like and subscribe today. But let's have a quick look over at Rotherham. We're being waxed lyrical about all the great job that Paul Warren does, and it seems to have unravelled against Neil Warnock's men, Sam.
Yeah, fantastic result for Cardiff. And you know, I was mentioning this to Tom on the FL 72 last week. I could see Cardiff being the team that come from the middle of the pack and have a go at the playoffs. They're still quite a way off, but the form is good. None of those other teams have really got a big run together. Norwich are inconsistent.
They're close to the playoffs now than they are the relegation.
Yeah, yeah, it's a fantastic job. When we were saying probably a couple of months ago, it's probably not quite happened yet for Neil Warnock, but the last couple of months, quietly away, they've been picking up some fantastic results as they came to Leeds and won, and they're just doing that job on teams now, week after week, and results like that. You know, Rotherham, even though they're bottom of the league and have had a hopeless season, you know, in the last few weeks under Paul Warren, they've been playing well. The games have been close. All of a sudden, Cardiff at home, you know, hammered them 5-0, and yeah, they are quite a bit away, but there's still plenty of time to go and get those results and get those points on the board. I'm tipping Cardiff to finish definitely in the top eight, and I think they're going to have a real good go at top six. But as I said, the top six is probably one of the best opportunities you'll ever get for the sides at the moment to really kick on and secure their places. So it's going to be tough for anyone trying to break in, but I think Cardiff is going to get quite close under Neil Warnock.
Well, it's interesting. Obviously, three wins, that shows everything can do for you. If Neil Warnock stays next season, I think they'll be up and around there.
I think he will stay as well, because he went to Cardiff with the mantra of, yeah, I can get these promoted in 2 years. That's what he said. They said they'd give him a bit of a budget. You've already seen in January he started to bring in some of his own players, some of his old reliables, like Greg Halford suddenly turned up at Cardiff, and he's doing quite well. Paddy Kenny, of course, will be there sooner rather than later. So,
no doubt about that. He'll definitely be there
next season. But you know what? I think Sam's right. Potentially, one side always has a run, and at the minute, the gap between the six and the others, you would think that they may just miss out, because the top six should finish in the top six now because of the gap. But if one of those starts to fall away, and you know, Leeds are the team in recent weeks that have started to drop points, then you never know. There's a lot of football left to be played.
Yeah, you're right there. And one team that won't be making a run is Rotherham. They are just finished. I've got nothing new to say. Paul Ward is doing a great job in trying to turn things around, but it just looks even worse now. And they look absolutely cut adrift for me. Well, let's have a look down at League One, shall we? And reluctantly, let's have a look over at Bradford City. It was a great first half performance, there's no doubt about that. 2-0 up in 16 minutes, it looked like it was going to be the worst nightmare return for Phil Parkinson. But Bolton managed to get the draw, and it feels like a loss for Bradford fans, Joe.
Well, I mean, you were at the game, so maybe you're better than us to analyse it. But for me, two goalkeeping errors, really, to gift Wyke, you know, the goals and give Bradford a 2-0
lead. Oh, yeah, he was awful. He was absolutely... He couldn't find a man when he was kicking out as well. I thought, this is unbelievable.
He did look a pretty poor goalkeeper. But then to allow Bolton to come back in it after being two up, you know, Stuart McCall will be absolutely furious. And it's another draw. I mean, we were looking, myself and Derek, in the newsroom here about the record amount of draws for a season, and it's 23 that's Norwich currently the holders, and we're both going to stick £10 on it. We're going to ring the bookmakers and see if we can get odds on Bradford breaking that record, because what with 13 games to play, you know, they need 7 more draws, and I can't argue with that. The way they've gone all season.
In the post-match interview afterwards, didn't Stuart McCall say, well, we could win 7, we could win 10 of those last 13. You'd be putting the bet on them to draw 7 of them rather than winning 10 at the moment. Yeah, 16 draws for the season is
sounds like
is
Sam's coming in with us as well.
Give me the odds and then we'll have a go. Yeah, but just, again, it's just, as we said in recent weeks, you know, they tried to address the lack of goals in January. Charlie Wyke gets another couple of goals, but again, second half they're conceding, and you know that where they were tight at the start of the season, they're starting to ship goals at the other end. So it's just inconsistencies for Bradford, and when it looks like they're getting one area of the pitch right, something happens at the other end and leaking some goals. So not a great result. 2-0, everyone was thinking it's, you know, the time to get a win. It's going to, you know, force us up the table. And as we said, look at the fifth and sixth and the gap in the Championship. There isn't a gap in League One at all. The teams right outside the playoffs are all in touching distance. So it is a bit concerning for Bradford when you have the opportunities to win and not taking them. If they play like they did in the second half, you know, for a full 90 minutes, or the form turns like that, then you know that they're going to be the team to drop out. I think it is a bit of a concern.
Having seen Bradford more than us two, what's gone on with the defence in recent weeks?
Well, I think the biggest problem, instead of being able to talk about goals and saying the goals are the biggest problem for Bradford, it's seeing games out. They're 1-0 up against Fleetwood, and this is the biggest problem for me. 5 points have been dropped this week against promotion rivals. Now, that's a lot. You know, if they'd have gained 6 points this week, we'd all be saying, wow, Bradford out, they're doing fantastic, they're definitely going to be in the playoffs and all the rest of it. It just seems like there are a few voices saying that you know, they might miss out on the playoffs. At the end of the day, Stuart McCall's had to do a total new job. You know what I mean? There's a lot of quality in that team. It would be a disaster if they didn't make the playoffs because of the quality in the team. You know, look at that. Evancelot's been absolutely fantastic. Charlie Wyke coming in has been brilliant. Colin Doyle, Nathaniel Knight-Percival, you know, Nicky Law's been out, and Matt Marshall has just been absolutely outstanding. I'd give my organs to that man. But, you know, I look at it
he'd
now...
He'd die for him, man.
But I just look at it now, you know, rest of the season, Sheffield United away, Scunthorpe away, the top two look, you know, like they're just too far away now. They can consolidate and get a playoff spot. Brilliant work towards next season. But I think there's a few panicky ones, and it didn't help that Phil Parkinson's return. The noise levels at Bradford were absolutely unbelievable on Saturday as well. It's not been like that since the Scunthorpe game, probably on Boxing Day. But, I mean, it's looking at what's next now for Bradford, and they certainly need to pick up 3 points sooner rather than later. And Port Vale, a great place to do it.
It seems almost psychological now, though, for Bradford, at seeing games out and getting the wins. And, yeah, the problem is the likes of Fleetwood and Millwall have come out of nowhere and put together great runs, and they're suddenly there inside the top six. And And Bradford need a win sooner rather than later just to get this monkey off their back, because, like I say, I think it's psychological now. It's not. You know, the players in the squad, they have the goal scoring right now. Defensively, for the past 3 years, they've been awesome, but that seems to have just dropped off. It is worrying times for Bantam supporters.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's any reason. I mean, the first goal, obviously, for Bolton, it was a scrappy one. It was just one of those where the luck went against you. When it's 2-1, and when, you know, 20,000 fans all suddenly go, oh, get a bit nervous, that can translate to the players. I can understand it. A win against Port Vale, I think that is exactly what Bradford need now. They need to get that win against Port Vale and really start getting that run together again. And I think they'll be up there in the playoffs. I really don't think it's... I can understand that there's some worry, but I don't think it's a time to panic yet, anyway. Let's have a look at Sheffield United. They were in action against Scunthorpe, and seemed like a really tasty time at Bramall Lane. We're talking about the atmosphere at Bradford with 21,000. 27,000 over at Bramall Lane, and a fantastic atmosphere.
Yeah,
unbelievable.
That's the potential of Sheffield United. And, you know, that is a good point against one of your promotion rivals. Sheffield United, of course, in pole position, top of the table. Surprise, surprise, Madden and Sharp, the two on the score sheet. I mean, you wouldn't have got good odds on those two both scoring, because they've been the heroes for both of those sides throughout the season. Billy Sharp, just unbelievable, the run that he's been on. But yeah, Chris Wilder said after the game, look, it's a good point. Against the relegation rivals, all we need to do is not lose. The promotion rivals, rather. All we need to do is not lose. And they didn't, did they? So, you know, happy days, as you would say, for the Blades.
Yeah, no doubt about that. I fully expect to be in the top two, Sam.
Indeed, yeah, they should go and win the league, shouldn't they? But a good result at the weekend for them. And as you said, the two crowds... fantastic. We want both teams back in the Championship next year if possible, but Sheffield United look like the one that are odds on to do so.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Let's move down a league then as well. Let's have a look over at Doncaster. No winning four for Doncaster. That was as soon as I was saying, oh, they're going to do fantastic and win it. Jinxed them. I still think they will win it. I still think that they definitely won't drop out the automatics. But a 1-1 draw with Luton.
Well, it's another one similar to Sheffield United. It's a must-not-lose game. So you take a point against Luton, who are fourth, so they're the nearest rival to sneaking into that top three. Because remember, League Two, it's three automatic places. And I think Darren Ferguson would have taken that before kickoff, despite Doncaster being at home. It's decent, you know, a 1-1 draw against your promotion. Just, they're the games that if you're above your rivals, you just don't need to lose. And then you pick up points against the teams at the lower end of the table. And, you know, that's what Donny have done. And I can't see them not getting promoted. In fact, I think it's an interesting race to see who will get promoted first, Doncaster Rovers or Sheffield United.
Certainly very interesting to see what happens there. And as formerly, Mr. York has joined us as well. We've got to have a quick chat about what's happening at Bootham Crescent. A 1-1 draw with Boreham Wood this weekend, Sam.
Yeah, another draw. I said, I don't know if we some rings, I expect York to kind of do that job that Sam Allardyce was talking about, and slowly, you know, keep picking up points week after week, which they are doing. But some of the teams around starting to win as well. Guys, they won at the weekend, so it's tough down at the bottom for York. But yeah, another draw, another point on the table, and yeah, again, you know, Gary Mills just getting that confidence back into the team, because it was completely destroyed at York. So it's a difficult job when you're trying to recover from such a bad position. You know, look at Rotherham, they've failed completely to have any kind of recovery. But at least York, from the terrible start, they're putting points on the board, and they're slowly moving themselves up. And as I said, I think they'll pull away clear in the next kind of month.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Looking at guys, I mean, they brought in John Rooney as now, Wayne Rooney's brother.
I know, I was about to say, he scored as well on his debut.
He certainly did.
I think
he
so.
Did.
Yeah, Rooney doing the business. Look, I think out of the Yorkshire sides down there, the two that they really should both survive when you look at the budgets, and that is York and Guiseley. North Ferriby punching above their weight to be in that division. And I see no reason why both of those two clubs can't put together runs that can get them clear of trouble, but it's difficult to do that when you're down in the mire.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Well, lads, it's been an absolute pleasure talking Yorkshire football with you as always. Thanks a lot for joining us.
Pleasure.
We'll be back same time next week to review all of the Yorkshire football in action. Remember to like and subscribe to Radio Yorkshire Today for all your latest Yorkshire footballing news. I'll be back same time next week. Remember to get in touch with those comments as well. Thanks for watching.